The following is a presentation from the MJCast, the internet's premier podcast on all things Michael Jackson.
You're listening to the MJCast, by MJ fans, for MJ fans.
The idea is to innovate, or else why am I doing it?
When I create my music, I feel like an instrument of nature.
You let it create itself, really. I know I do.
And I love to entertain. That's one of my favorite things. Simply Michael Jackson.
Welcome to the MJCast, your source of news and discussion on the King of Pop.
Hello and welcome to episode 97 of the MJCast. I'm Jamon Bull and we're kicking off season 5. Sorry about our extended break between seasons, but hey, you did get three or so surprise episodes during that time. Today we're lucky enough to have Michael Jackson's head of security during his latter years, Mr. Bill Whitfield. Q and Elise will be back next episode, but until then, I'm here today with my guest co-host and no stranger to listeners, author of Michael Jackson, Songs and Stories from the Vault, Damien Shields. Hey Damien, how are you?
Good, thanks Jamon, thanks for having me. Bill not only served as Michael's head of security in the final years of his life, a time that continues to fascinate fans around the world, but he's also a published author. Bill's book, Remember the Time, Protecting Michael Jackson in His Final Days, details Bill's 3 years as Jackson's chief bodyguard. This was a time when Michael was putting the pieces of his life back together after securing his freedom following 14 not guilty verdicts in his 2005 child molestation trial and was attempting to rebuild his career. Bill Whitfield, welcome to the MJCast.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, Bill, thank you so much for joining us on the MJCast. We're absolutely thrilled to talk with people who knew and worked with the King of Pop, Michael Jackson. But in this case, it's very, very special because you actually had a very unique job in that you had to defend and protect the safety of the most famous individual on the planet. So very excited to talk to you about that. Thank you again for joining us.
Certainly. Thank you for having me.
Now, normally when we interview guests who knew and worked with Michael Jackson, we like to go right back to their origins and find out how they actually got into the industry that they ended up working in. So please, Bill, take us back. Talk to us about how you got into the world of security.
I do come from a law enforcement background where things just started with me protective, securing level. After a short term in law enforcement, I was offered a job, head of security for the security manager for Radio City Music Hall in New York City. If you know Radio City Music Hall in New York, every celebrity comes through there at one time or another. You know, they have the Grammys there. The Oscars is one of the shows that I've coordinated security for in L.A. 3 times. You know, my history goes back, you know, from the infamous P. Diddy, Andre Harrell, Russell Simmons, and then I was overseeing security for Motown Records. So I've delved in a lot of security work while in New York City. It was security positions and details that brought me to Las Vegas, which I was supposed to only come for a couple of weeks, and I took a liking to Vegas. I like the weather. It's nice out here. So
you mentioned a couple of names there of people who you have been security for. Are there any other noteworthy celebrities that people might know that you've worked for in the past?
Whitney Houston, Shaquille O'Neal.
In what period of time did you work with Whitney and Shaquille?
Oof. Shaquille was, let me see. You asked me to go back now. Yeah, you asked me to start using my brain here.
Which decade?
early 2000s.
So before Michael.
Oh, yeah, that's before Michael, definitely. And Whitney was back in late 97, 8.
It really wasn't your first foray into protecting royalty. I mean, like, Whitney Houston is one of the biggest singers ever. And Shaquille is one of the biggest sports stars ever. Those are pretty big jobs. It's not only, you know, their own security is important, but they're an icon. They're someone that's, like, you're protecting them for them, but you're protecting them for the world. That's pretty unique position to be in.
Well, you certainly never wanted anything to happen to someone with that status, something to happen to them on your watch. That would not be forgotten. I've often heard, you know, I was in one place and Mr. Jackson was in the other when he passed. You know, I was taking care of some other business for him, but people often ask me, you should have been there. What if you were there? I've had my thoughts about the what ifs and this. I'm not a doctor. I don't know how I would have reacted. Certainly would have been panic mode for everybody. Because that's not, I don't think that's a situation that you're trained for. I've trained for a lot of situations. That was not one of them.
He passed in the privacy of his bedroom, which is, right. I mean, right. Is that your area even? I mean, is that even your place to be? Like, surely there is a moment where Michael Jackson, the human being, has a moment of solitude and you don't go in there. Like, how would anybody know what's going on behind his closed doors when he's trying to sleep? Like, that should be his most intimate time.
Right? Certainly. Yeah, but no, I've been in his bedroom before, and that was certainly upon being invited, you know, to whether surreal things. Anytime we left the house and came back, we did a full surveillance of the house before we allowed him to even just go in it. We didn't just roll up and let him go. No, it was never like that. No, we had to go in throughout the house everywhere to make sure things was good. You know, there was a time where I wasn't there, but, you know, he mentioned to us there was a girl that snuck into Neverland and stayed there for 4 days. She stayed in the closet. So she would come out the closet at night or when things was quiet, either use the restroom or get something to eat. For 4 days, she stayed in the closet. And he came down in the middle of the night and seen her at the table eating.
Oh, my goodness. Could you imagine doing that? Like coming out late at night to your kitchen, get something to eat and somebody's sitting there? My goodness.
Exactly. You know, just on safety purposes, you know, for us, it would be unusual to know what his bedroom looked like. That was no big deal.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, some of these names you were talking about before, would you say that you established as close a relationship with some of those celebrities as you ended up doing with Michael Jackson or?
No, I certainly established a personal relationship with them, but it wasn't as deep with Miss Jackson. Cause those are individuals. You got to remember those individuals, certainly are public figures as well, but they're private figures as well, but they were well receptive in the public to where there were no onslaught of crowds and people getting trampled going out with them. You know, it wasn't like that. So their need to get up and go was a lot easier than Mr. Jackson. You know, they want to go to the mall and movies and go shopping. We can do that without having to go through the thoroughness that we would do as Mr. Jackson, because we knew going out with him in public is sometimes like a damn volcano that may and may not erupt. And we have to be prepared for that when it came to Mr. Jackson. These other individuals, you know, people certainly admired them and wanted their autographs. Mr. Jackson, he very rarely did he leave his home if he didn't have to. So we took care of a lot of personal things for him. And the more and more you're dealing with him on that matter and finding out the things he wants, he needs, kind of things he likes from the store, you kind of get to know them more personal, more deeper of what they like. They like to eat, you know, and things like just you find out a hell of a lot more because they really depend on you. You know, but all these other celebrities, I mean, you know, certainly we did tasks for them, things they may have wanted, but it was more easy for them to just get out in public. So
in the book, there's a really cute story where Michael's in a public place and there's a bit of hysteria building and his whole way of saying, let's calm this down by saying that I'm Prince. one of the biggest artists in the world, but like, yeah. When you compare the stature and the level of public interest to Michael Jackson, nobody can compare. It doesn't matter how big they are. And that's just a really great example of like, you know, tell them I'm one of the biggest artists in the world and they won't be interested because there's no one as interesting as Michael Jackson. It doesn't matter who they are.
That was the time I came up with that. Mr. Jackson ain't come up with that. Give me my credit now. So no, that was, yeah, we was in, I believe, a Walmart somewhere in Virginia. He was covered up a little bit, but there was something about Mr. Jackson that no matter what he covered up, well, you know, other than the motorcycle outfit that we put him in, no one ever recognized him in that. But the way he chose to come out in public thinking a scarf covering my whole face, nothing shown but my eyes, put on some gloves, whether he put on some black slacks or he had to just, you know, the flannel pajama bottoms. Listen, people knew who he was. It was the way he walked. It was his demeanor. People knew, and he kept wondering how the hell these people know who I am. Because he felt he was covered up good. And we used to look at him from a distance, like if we weren't working for him, we have to look at him for a minute and say, you know what? What do we think? That's Michael Jackson. And for a minute, you're like, yeah. Yes, it's just something. He wasn't good at his disguises at all. And he would always ask us, how do people keep finding out who I am? And it's like, I wanted to give him the hard truth, you know, which is, Mr. Jackson, everybody know who the hell you are. He just had swag. Sometimes I often wondered, does he realize how big he is? I wondered, did he realize that? Knowing that you're famous and successful and you have admirers and fans, but do you realize how big you are? I don't know if he realized that. Yeah, he's seen all the people come to his concerts, but I don't think he understood. No, these people like you and feeling you have love for you outside of your damn concert. I don't think he understood that.
And Bill, for those listeners who haven't read your book yet, could you talk to us about how you originally first came to work for Michael Jackson?
Well, there's a friend of mine that I've been doing some personal security details with named Jeff Adams. And I've known Mr. Adams for, at the time, maybe close to 15 years. And we've done details from time to time and done some traveling work. And he'd given me a call telling me he had a client coming to town and they needed escort from point A, point B. You know, in those terms, point A, point B is where they're landing, where they're coming in from, and point B is their destination to where they're going to be going. So they needed, you know, just pretty much a safe passage. I took the gig and certainly sure, and we did our pre-advance. And I, at the time, I didn't even ask who it was because it really didn't matter. If we had a detail to just escort someone from point A to point B, and I felt that's all it would be. So as for who they were, I wasn't concerned with that. I was more concerned with just the detail, you know, what my responsibility was. So once the family came in and, you know, I still didn't see who they were when they got off the plane. Again, I was less concerned. I was more concerned with just, you know, our surroundings, what was going on. And once we got back to our location, back to the house, I helped a little bit with bringing some luggage in the house. And I figured, hey, we good, cool. I'm ready to get the hell out of here. And that's when I was told to hold up. The client wants to meet you. But I'm sorry, just prior to that, I did ask the guy. The guy said to me, Jeff said to me, did you see who that was? And I said, nah, I just said some skinny dude. And with a few kids. And I said, get the hell out of here. And he said, word up. I said, really? I said, well, I'm like, I got a little nervous. Michael Jackson? Now, I've been with some celebrities before. That's it. It don't get no bigger than Michael Jackson, period. It's everybody else, Michael Jackson, thank God. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, that's it. You know, well, as I was concerned, having grown up and big fan of, you know, Jackson 5 and all that stuff. So I was like, wow. I was like, yo, can you think you can get an autograph for my daughter? And he's like, hold on, man, you might get more than an autograph. I was like, oh, shit. Like, I'll take a few pictures. You know what I'm saying? I was a little excited. Cool. Asked me to come inside and introduce me. Motherfucker introduced me to Michael Jackson. I was tripping. I really was. No one's ever made me feel that way. And I've been around a lot of people. And I was like, wow, this is crazy right now. You know, that's told me, you know, it was an honor. You know, I was a big fan. And we talked about Motown Records, you know, because I worked for Motown Records for a little bit. And I don't know, he has some history with Motown. And then he called the kids over and I introduced them to me. For a moment, I'm wondering why is this introduction going longer than I thought it should be? Because normally I've met people, hey, how you doing, Bill? so-and-so, and this so-and-so, and that's it. All right, everybody, good night. But when after I met the little ones and he said to them that Bill is our new head of security, I was in awe right now. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? That's why he's playing a trick on me. I looked at Jeff, like I gave him a look like, what the fuck is going on? So it was Jackson. They said they were tired. They were going up to bed. He said, we'll see you in the morning, right? I said, yes, sir. So how I got pulled into that position, I don't know. Other than when he told me that we had the detail and they said, he said, the client wants a copy of your resume, you know, and, you know, there's some background information that they needed. And I provided that. But I guess on my resume, the whole Motown thing is what was, I don't know if that was impressive. I don't know if that was a sign. I don't know.
Shaquille O'Neal and Whitney Houston. I mean, Michael Jackson worked with Shaquille O'Neal.
They were on the resume. Friends with Whitney. But they were certainly on the resume, but he didn't mention any of that. You know, all he said was, I see you work for Motown. And I said, yes, sir. And he says, it's a lot of good times there. And that was only questioning toward, you know, the resume. But then that was really it. That was the start of the journey.
And the journey, how many years did you end up working with Michael?
Up until his death, I was employed. December 22nd, 06. When he came into town, that was it.
Talk to us about Mike and Javon. They were brought in later, right?
Yeah, they were brought in later, yes. Yeah, there was a few guys that assisted with the security that evening, but these guys were, you know, they were pretty much there just for the night and safe passage, you know, from A to B. Then after that night, we had to figure it out.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. And of course, there was a movie that came out a little while ago on Lifetime called Searching for Neverland. And of course, in that film, you were portrayed by Chad Coleman. And I think he did an outstanding job myself. And to me, like the most compelling element of that film was your relationship with Michael and your portrayal. And especially the early part of the movie, the story you just described about meeting Michael for the first time was just really, really awesome to watch on screen. So talk to us about what your thoughts were of the film and how you were portrayed by Chad.
Oh, I think Chad did a great job. We talked often. We spoke often. You know him. You know, I know he's read the book, and he certainly referred back to it as much as he could. But he and I spoke often to just try to capture, you know, exactly what we were going through or what I was going through. You know, to have to carry out this detail.
And speaking of the detail itself, I mean, way back in season one of the MJCast in episode 5, we were lucky enough to speak to Kerry Anderson, who was Michael's head of security during his trial in the mid-2000s and also for a portion of time when he was in the Middle East. Now, when Michael came back to the US eventually and you picked up the reins and took over as head of security, talk to us about your day-to-day work and what it entailed for you.
Well, Mr. Jackson was not, you know, certainly was not performing at the time. There was a lot of meetings going on. But when he first landed, you know, got into Vegas, he had an itinerary that was prepared for either his managers and or his nanny. He knew very well that also handled a lot of personal matters. So he had an itinerary. Who he's going to be calling, who's going to be calling him, who's going to be visiting, where he needed to go. If we had dinner arrangements, you know, we have to do a detail to ensure safe passage to and from was there. So it really depended, but he was someone that had a daily itinerary, just as the kids did during the week. Did have a school teacher that traveled. So everything with Mr. Jackson was concerned and where the kids was concerned, there was a daily schedule for them. You know, whether there was something that he needed from the store that was on the schedule that we needed to pick up and retrieve, we do that. But if there was some places that he needed to travel to with a few hours within notice, that we'd be able to prepare a safe passage. So it really depends. Did he leave the house much? Not really.
And let's say he did want to leave the house for something like, say, going to a shopping mall or something like that. How extensive was the preparation for you guys, including like, you know, any site surveys or anything you might have had to do?
We would certainly do a pre-advanced detail on just going to the mall, find out what the best time of the day to go. Like if he woke up, he was never one to say he wanted to do something immediately because he understood what our roles were. He understood. So we really didn't do anything at the spur of the moment unless it was something that he did not have to get out the car. Like if he wanted to take the kids to get some ice cream, we don't have to get out the car for that. He wants to take the kids to McDonald's, we don't have to get out the car for that. But anything that he was getting out of the car, we had to do a few hours pre-advanced detail to ensure whatever was going on at that location was calm enough for us to feel comfortable enough to walk into and to know what our egress and ingress would be to remove ourselves from the situation quickly if needed. So times that he would be getting out the vehicle, we definitely prepared for that. If we knew he wasn't getting out the vehicle, we just go. Again, anytime he was getting out the vehicle, we had to pull out all the stops to ensure that wherever we were going, we'd be able to handle ourselves and at least exit immediately and effectively if necessary.
Were there any times that you did go out with Michael where you were concerned about his safety, like when any potentially dangerous situations arose?
Dangerous, anytime too many people start to form is dangerous. You got so many people. We've been in several situations where, the onslaught of fans and admirers, onlookers have bombarded us and it became too dangerous either for the kids or not only certainly for Mr. Jackson, but when you got that many fans and onlookers and people screaming, the possibility of someone throwing something, shooting something, or physically doing something, it would be hard to know where it's coming from. So anytime I felt that we were in a situation that I felt that we are at a visual disadvantage, it's time to go. We didn't allow it to get to that level. We monitored it getting to that level. And as it got close, it was time to go. Mr. Jackson never questioned me whenever I made a decision to bounce.
Just a quick shift of gears. What was one of your favorite moments that you spent with Michael? Something that comes to mind as one of your favorite things that you shared together or that you did for him or with him?
A lot of laughable moments. I loved seeing and hearing him smile and or laugh at something. And if you knew me well enough, and I felt comfortable enough being my personal self at times with Mr. Jackson, and I would say certain things. It just got to a point to where, you would just make little comments, and he was very shy. Absolutely, very shy. And there's several moments, but one of the moments that stick out for me is when we were in, I believe it was in Georgetown. We were at a red light and there was a young lady on a corner to our left. And she's just like, she's about, ready to cross the street, waiting for the light. And he goes, wow. He said, wow, look at her. She's beautiful. And I'm like, I looked over and I'm like, wow, she's hot. She's cute. Long hair, curly hair chick. She was cute. I said, you want to meet her? And he said, no. I said, all right. So the light changed and I drove off. But I said to myself, you know what? I'm going for it. So he didn't realize what I was doing because he just thought I was just driving. And I'm driving. I turned around and I made it back to where that young lady was walking. And she was walking, like, across the street. She started walking down this block, As a matter of fact, she's walking toward Georgetown University. And so I pulled up to her, And I said, hello, excuse me. I said, hey, how you doing? I'm sorry to bother you. But, you know, listen, I'm doing a personal security detail for someone and they would love to meet you. She says, what is it like? What do you got, like Michael Jackson back there? I was like, oh, shit. And I said, Mr. Jackson. He said, Bill, no. And I'm like, Mr. Jackson, she's right there. You might as well say hello. So he put the window down. He said, hello. He said, you know, oh, my God, I didn't know he was going to do this. So it was like I did what I could to bring some form of normalcy to his life. You know, me, you, we out and about, we see people, you know, and we'll approach them if we want to say something to them. That was not him. He was never in that position to just meet someone, you know, on his accord. Everybody's always coming to him. And who they run into? They run into Michael Jackson, the King of Pop. I think he really wanted that to be that guy to kind of make the first move via an introduction to someone. And I put him in that situation. He was embarrassed, but then he just started asking her questions. You know, like, what was she doing out here? She said she was going to school. He said, what are you going to school to be? And I found that strange because normally when you and I, we meet somebody that's going to school, we'll say, what are you studying? He said, what are you going to be? Because in his mind, people go to school or go to college to be something in general. You know, we've had that conversation about the whole education before. So just one of my memories is just having, I put him on the spot to say hello to someone. And it was like he was pretty much making the first move instead of someone coming at him. And that's what I know he wanted that. I know he needed that. But it was so funny the way he was caught off guard introducing himself. You know, there was the girl asked a couple of times, you know, is he really? And, you know, are you really Michael Jackson? You know. But I think he tried to keep the conversation to what she was doing. What's going on? You know, where you're from? You know. So I keep that in mind. The normalcy things that we've tried to bring in his life.
Yeah, I find that absolutely fascinating, and what a wonderfully told story. Thank you.
Thank you. this is Diana Walczak, sculptor of the Michael Jackson history statue, and you're listening to the MJ Cast.
As you've probably heard, there's a documentary out there at the moment directed by Dan Reed called Leaving Neverland, which is, you know, causing a lot of controversy around the world. It portrays Michael Jackson as a child molester, as a pedophile. And I've got to ask, as somebody that spent a lot of time with Michael Jackson daily for years, how sure are you that Michael Jackson was interested in women?
We spent, you know, when you spend a lot of time with someone, you know, people are often ask me, how long did I work for him? Well, that's not really a long time. No, you spend almost every day with somebody. It's a long goddamn time. And especially when they need you, they depend on you. I mean, it got to the point to where I tell people like this. We all had a boss before that got on our goddamn nerves. Michael Jackson was my boss. And I assure you, there were times he got on my goddamn nerves. So we were able to drop our guards. I'm a very private person, very private, reserved. And he would be that kind as well, because he's not one to volunteer information. You have to ask him. You have to talk to him, you know. And I've always found myself that way. So the more and more we were around each other, we would find ourselves just talking about general things. And I think that's something he enjoyed doing, is just talking about things other than business. You know what I'm saying? So I think that's what his life, you know, certainly entails so much of, business. So he enjoyed having a conversation that had nothing to do with business. You know, so there was times when just to out and about, we drive and I'll see women. And I ask him, so Jackson, what do you think about her? You think she's cute? He'll look at her. Her hair's too short. Okay. So we named a few people before, and I asked him before, you know, coming up, if he could date somebody, you know, who were people that he found attractive? He named Halle Berry. What's that chick that married Seal?
Halle
Berry. He thought she was hot. When we have them kind of say, guys, dudes, we're having conversations about women. I mean, you're not thinking whether he likes women or not. It's right there, because I don't need you thinking whether I like women or not. We're having a conversation about women. So obviously, as two men, that's what our preference is. In my line of work, observation is key. And I paid attention. Attention, Mr. Jackson. It was important for me to pay attention. I need to know. I had to somewhat put myself in a position to try to know the answer before he even asked me. So I paid attention to things. So when it comes to when people ask you, as you question, how would I know? Or how did I know? Or how could I be sure? I mean, I didn't see no signs of anything otherwise, because I know what our conversations were. We talked about women. We talked about we never got explicit as to graphic and all that kind of stuff. No, we didn't have a talk about women about on a sexual nature. We had a talk about women, who was beautiful, who's attractive.
The book covers that there was a few women that Michael did have relationships with. Can you speak to that while we're on the topic?
Well, at least one. You know, we say relationships, you know, certainly he spent more personal time with one young lady in particular, though one other did come visit and they hung out. I mean, we took them to dinner, went for walks. You know, they stayed in one hotel, he stayed with his kids. And, you know, in the mornings we would, you know, either go pick him up, go pick her up, and we just drive. So that was, I thought that was something that one particular was more of a friendship. Two people that just really admired one another as friends. But there was another particular one that I think there was a little more going on. Certainly, he spent more quality time with her, you know, pretty much only in the back seat, you know, because the vehicles in which we had a curtain, like a black curtain that you couldn't see in the back seat. This particular young lady came to town, which she only came to town at one time, that they hung out and I mean, it was about 2:30 in the morning. We drove downtown D.C., walked around the Lincoln Memorial and all those, that downtown Washington, D.C. buildings, all these, you know, all the business areas down there at the Vietnam Wall, hung out, you know, and they walked as a couple would walk, holding hands. It was a little breezy, so there was a little closeness just walking. They had their little personal conversation they had going on, just talking about whatever. I knew what he had with this young lady was different than the other young lady. You know, because the other young lady was just pretty much just really a solid friendship. This one here seemed like more of an attractiveness to one another. Just the way they walked and talked and giggled and shit. It, for a moment, it sounded like two fucking teenagers just giggling and shit. And in the back seat, you can hear the sound of kissing, you know, but to us, it was normal. It was no big deal. Like, dudes having some private time. Nothing else crazy going on. I know that. But just knowing that he had someone in his life that sharing a personal moment with other than business. That's what we observe. That's what I've seen. And when I hear all these other, you know, I don't even like defending it. I don't. I really don't. Because some people's minds are made up. Who the hell am I for them to believe me? You know, but when we come across the fans that do believe otherwise, you know, I enjoy talking to them. Because those are the people that he cared for and that he appreciated.
Yeah, and it's so sad that there's people out there like Dan Reed, Wade Robson, and Jimmy Safechuck that want to push this false narrative that Michael Jackson loved to spend, you know, inordinate amount of times alone in a bedroom with young boys being a pedophile. Now, I need to talk with you and get your stories down on the record. You're an incredibly important person in Michael Jackson's life. During this time, you were his head of security, and I need to ask, did you see Michael spending alone time with young boys in his bedroom?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Mr. Jackson was very, very naive in some way. I've often heard people say, you know, he didn't have a childhood. You know, I've heard that before. Even prior to working for him, or that whole he didn't have a childhood and all that. You know, and, you know, I would be quick to wonder, what does that matter, you know? But when I got to work with him, around him, for him, I'm seeing it now. I'm seeing the naiveness of what he's never experienced. Like you and I, you know, I like to think that we've grown up, we go through middle school, high school, we hang out, we go to proms, we go to basketball games, baseball games, we go to school pep rallies. Hanging around all these people, around our friends, we learn different things about people, different lingo. You learn different things when you're around a bunch of different people. You're just one of many in the spot, but the spotlight is not on you. You're part of everything going on. Now, Mr. Jackson coming up, what I've noticed was he didn't have that. He didn't have all them basketball games and hanging out, pep rally, going to school prom and all that. He didn't have that. So his verbiage is going to be what he learned in the books that he read or read every day. Very smart man. His language and the way he spoke was very, very articulate when he spoke. He's used words that I didn't know what the hell he was talking about sometimes. Very smart. So when I think about people saying the whole pedophile, I'm like, damn, where y'all get that from? Because I guess me, I was inside the bubble, so I knew what the hell was going on. If you're outside the bubble and you're looking in, you don't know what it's like to be inside here. So you're going to have your opinions. And that's what people go on now with, well, he, you know, around a bunch of kids. I can really only speak on my watch and in the character that I observed. He's wanted to help kids. We all know him having helped cancer patients and, you know, all that, you know, and being a humanitarian, of all the work that he's done on that level. So many people have turned his helping or his wanting to help kids into such a negative thing. So when I heard, I've watched the videos of him saying, there's nothing wrong with sharing my bed. Now, if I heard that from the outside the bubble, I'd be like, man, that shit ain't cool. I'm inside the bubble. I know what he's saying. He's not talking about, I'm going to get into bed with another motherfucker. You can hit, here's my bed. You can have my bed for the night. That's sharing my bed. You're not going to take the shit with you when you leave. I'm going to share it with you. Him saying that, I see how that shit can be taken in a different direction. Mr. Jackson was laying up in the bed with no kids. One, definitely not on my watch.
One of the criticisms that the Michael Jackson fans have of the media is the fact that the media tells one side of the story. What the fans are trying to do at the moment with this Leaving Neverland protest movement is allowing the facts to come to light and trying to give the public the ability to assess the situation, not just based on what the media wants us to hear, but the whole other side with the exculpatory evidence that shows that Michael Jackson didn't do these things.
Mm-hmm.
To be completely journalistically fair right now, to play devil's advocate, and I want to preface this with, I do not believe that this would have ever happened. But if you did see Michael engaging in something that you didn't think was an acceptable behavior, as your job as the head of security, what is your level of interject? Like, do you interject? What was your role to ask? Hang on, I'm witnessing this. This doesn't seem right. And what do you do about it if it happens? And I'm not saying that you did, and I'm not saying that it even could have happened. But if in any circumstance you see something that your client is doing that isn't right, what is your duty of care in that moment?
Doing a job, doing a security job, being head of security, executive protection, that is a job. That is a hat that you put on, and you go and you wear that hat, you go perform that job. You see something that's inappropriate to where a grown-ass man is doing something with some little kids. Okay, I'm going to take this hat off for a minute. I'm going to take this hat off of being Mr. Jackson's security. Okay, I'm a black man. I'm somebody's father. I have a daughter. I have a child, a young child at that. I have morals. And I have certainly a level of responsibility of maintaining who the hell I am. So there would be no way in hell that I would even allow something such as that to happen and or continue on my watch. Would I have approached Mr. Jackson? Mr. Jackson is a grown ass man. I would have approached him like a grown ass man. I've said it before, I posted on my pages. Anybody that knows me, my friends from back home in New York, will tell you, if I witness anything like that where Mr. Jackson was concerned, I said it before, I will say it again. I would have kicked Mr. Jackson's ass myself. I mean that. Protection of children is something that I am a part of today. It's something I've been a part of yesterday. It's something I've always been a part of. I am a protector of those that are less fortunate, vulnerable, and that can't really defend themselves. So whenever I see something like that, countering something like that, I'm stepping in. I've often said it about celebrities, a lot of all the celebrities that get into trouble, that do, R. Kelly's main example. We have barriers to get to a client. I was the last line of defense. There were others before me that you have to get through to get to me and to get to the client. No one was going to get past me like in that manner. No one. Had I seen anything remotely to that? Oh, no. No. You ought to heard about it in the papers. You ought to heard something. It wouldn't have been pretty.
So keeping on the topic there, and we can transition into the Leaving Neverland film just quickly, because there's something that was claimed in that film, Bill, that falls within your watch during the time that Michael lived in Vegas in 2008. Wade Robson alleges that Michael Jackson and his children attended a barbecue or a lunch or something of that nature with Wade in Vegas in 2008. Being that you worked with Michael on a daily basis throughout the entirety of 2008, can you speak to that claim and give us a little bit of information about that period of time and your views on where that claim could come from and the validity of it?
I watched the Leaving Neverland documentary. I normally don't watch Michael Jackson stuff. I really don't. But when I was hearing that there were claims being made of some barbecue in 2008, I said, hold on, I need to watch this shit. I'm like, when the hell did this happen? So for anything like that, especially on my watch or my detail, I would have been the one to arrange the situation. Okay, that's one. Two, this dude, Wade Robson, whatever, he made it sound like he had the ability to contact Mr. Jackson at any time. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. No one was able to reach Mr. Jackson. And I say that is because it was a period that he wanted to be unreachable. Even in fact, his cell phone was in my name. The cell phone that he had was, I had taken a phone out on my account and he had that phone. So any calls, he didn't give his number to anybody. Any numbers that anybody that called him that had that number was certainly particularly his mom. So when I heard Mr. Rob Wayne Robson, whatever, say he just called him and arranged to have a cookout, I said that was it. That was kind of, I almost turned the TV off because that's what I knew. Okay, everything's coming out of his mouth right now. He went and brought some hot dogs. And Mr. Jackson asked him to bring him some wine. You know, I'm going to tell you something. When I heard that part, I said, he read my book. That's what I said. This man read my book. There was something that his mother said. Was it his mother? One of them moms had said something. And I said, they read my book. I knew that all that shit was fabricated. Well, a lot of it. Again, I can really only speak on what took place under my watch. But I also feel like I'm in a position to speak on Mr. Jackson's character. And a lot of words that they were using or things that they were saying that Mr. Jackson said back in the day, I said, no, that's not how Mr. Jackson talks. They're referencing someone that...
So just to be clear and definitive, There was no barbecue in 2008.
You're right. There was no barbecue. No, sir.
And if there was a barbecue, you would have been...
I would have known.
Involved with arranging.
I would have known the detail. I would have known setting it up.
So there wasn't a day at all in your time with Michael where Michael went rogue and went out without you and did something that you didn't know about.
One time he did go, he took a drive with the nanny. Grace.
Yeah,
Grace been around longer than all of us, so we didn't question that.
Well, just to be clear, when was that and do you know where they went?
No.
And which city was that in?
Las Vegas.
Okay. So there's no chance that that could have been the barbecue?
No, that didn't happen.
Okay.
It's hard to get people to see from my point of view or try to see the questions that I would ask. It's like if you watch the documentary, if this boy supposedly spent 7 years or knowing Mr. Jackson for 7 years and he was doing something to him for 7 years, they hung around, it was buddy-buddy families and everybody, where in the hell are the pictures? I keep asking these questions because every picture they showing up from concerts, where's the free time? All this time y'all spent together, where are the pictures from y'all just chilling out, hanging, having a good time? Here it is. You go to a cookout. You ain't seen Mr. Jackson in years. You going to Michael Jackson. Everywhere we go, this camera's flashing all the fucking time. You trying to tell me you took your wife and kids to see Mr. Jackson, Michael Jackson, you had a cookout, and not one goddamn picture? Come on, man. Who do you think you're talking to? Not one. 7 years. Not one picture.
A slight shifting gear again. Michael Jackson as a regular dad. He was a single father, three children, breakfast, school, outings, discipline, you know, advice, wisdom, bedtime. All of the things that a father does for his kids. What was that like in the world of Michael Jackson?
Well, I can only attest to when the kids were in the cars, out and about, before any time we got to a location, whether we were going to a mall or going to an amusement park, we were going to even just take the kids. He always had a quick speech with them, you know, learning to behave. You pay attention. You listen to what they tell you to do. And as for the whole in the house, what went on, breakfast, I can't really speak on that. I wasn't there too often enough to know how he spoke to them, but I know he ensured when it came to schooling, you know, we had a, you know, and a teacher that traveled with us, you know, certified teacher that had all the certifications to ensure that the kids were going through the proper educational and grading levels. He ensured we had a room in the house that we set up as a classroom. You know, kids got up every morning. School started at 8 o'clock. The boys wore, you know, the slacks, shiny shoes, white shirt, tie. Parents often wore that Catholic girl dress. They went to school as though like they were like in a real school. And that was under his direction. He ensured that. We took the kids on field trips. I know driving, times that we would be out and about, if the kids wanted something and he would make a comment, whichever one didn't do well enough in school, somebody was talking too much. You didn't do your homework. You didn't do, he disciplined on a level that they wouldn't get certain things. But it was in speeches. Everything he said was, to me, it was always like a lesson. It was like he's always pushing off knowledge, you know. But they would ask in the car, you know, can we go to McDonald's? Can we go to the park? And it was times he's like, no, you didn't do what I asked you to do, so we're not going. And it's like, wow, it's crazy to hear Mr. Jackson, Michael Jackson, like putting his foot down with his kids. It's like, this is something that people don't talk about. People don't, like, so it's new to us. Like, wow. So that side, but it also came normal. Came normal. Great dude, great father. I mean, and I would definitely tell if it was otherwise. Very concerning. I mean, it was in wintertime. We took the kids to the park, got the kids in the car, we drove off. Mr. Jackson called the car. Said, Bill, does Blanket have his gloves and his hat? I looked in the back seat, no hat, no gloves. He said, no, turn around. And I told him not to get his glove and hat. We had to turn around and go back and get the gloves and hat. But he was on top of things like that. When we were staying in Virginia, and he called, Bill, we are out of detergent. You know, we need more detergent. When I told one of the other guys to go to the store to get some detergent, and when he came back from the store, he said, yo, who's washing clothes? The nanny ain't here. I was like, oh, shit, she sure ain't. So it just made us wonder. We don't know. We didn't see him, you know, but we know there was those three young kids. We know they wasn't doing it. Was Michael Jackson really washing clothes? All I know, he asked for detergent and there was no nanny. So, you know, you can only assume.
It's mind-boggling that we look at Michael Jackson as someone who potentially couldn't wash clothes.
Yeah.
It's like, considering the capabilities and the achievements of his life, you know, mm-hmm. The biggest, most talented musician, entertainer, performer, ever. It's such a visionary to create new genres of film with the short films and music videos that he did, and the innovation of dance and the absolute cutting edge music. And then we go, wow, like he could use the washing machine. That's crazy. Right. It's just interesting. Yeah.
There was times that he would tell us that the kids don't have any more cereal. And he would just bring us out the empty box of which cereal to go pick up. Things that so many people would not imagine that Michael Jackson was doing out of normalcy, because I think that's what a lot of people don't understand about him. The normalcy effect of the things that's normal to us, but some people could not imagine him doing it.
Now, one of the things that we can imagine Michael doing is music. In your book, you talk about the fact that Michael, from time to time, had different people, different producers, engineers coming to the house to collaborate with him, going to the studio to collaborate and working on music. Do you remember any specific names, any particular producers that Michael was working with? Did he discuss any of his, you know, favorite collaborations or any of the songs that he was working on? Can you talk about that period of his life where music was involved and collaboration was involved, and perhaps if you even know of any of the songs that were being worked on during that period of time that we may, since his passing, have heard?
As for the people that came through that he was working with music on, Will.i.am, Akon, musical beats that would get sent to me via email, I'd burn the disc, give it to him. So how he worked and what he did inside the studio, certainly there's times in which I've stood by and I've been right there and watch him do what he's doing. It was never anything that I directly paid attention to, because you could get lost. You could get lost in Michael Jackson's world by just paying attention to him, watching what he do. But I had to mentally know what our jobs were, not get lost in this shuffle of the Michael Jackson world. I didn't pay attention to the work they were doing, because that was his world. That was his thing. Definitely a genius. I've listened. I've heard songs. I heard different songs. But again, that was his world. And I never intervened in that world unless I was called to come in.
And regarding the collaborations and the fact that it's often been referred to that Michael was a vagabond in those final years and moving around, and he never really spent an extensive period of time beyond, you know, a year or so in one particular place. Did the disruption of Michael's life, picking up from Vegas and going to Virginia, going to DC, going to New Jersey, going to New York, going back over to Los Angeles, did the constant move, did you feel or detect that there was any disruption to his creative process or like the progress of the work that he was kind of actively trying to do? Because by the time he passed away, he still never got the new music finished. He never released anything. Do you think that the lifestyle perhaps influenced his ability to get it done? Was it distracting, or can you speak to that at all?
I didn't see anything that would make me think that moving around, going from spot to spot, was interfering with what he's doing musically. Because honestly, all I know, he was working on new music. That's all I really knew. I would get sent tracks for him to sing over. I'd get the tracks, I'd burn the disc, I'd give it to him, and he's in the studio doing what he do. I didn't hang around him like that. Once he's in his studio, a studio, my job is to ensure to what's going on outside this studio. So I really can't speak on, you know, whether moving around played a part in his music. I don't know. You know, I didn't get that. I never got that sense, because everywhere we went, he still worked on his art. He still worked on his music. Everywhere we went, a different producer, you know, or choreographer would meet us, and they would just do their work. We moved around for reasons. Everywhere he went, there was a reason.
One of the most interesting residencies that Michael took up during those final years of his life, and it was a period in which you were around for, was the almost 3 months that Michael spent in New Jersey with the Cassio family. In one way, that visit is interesting because Living Neverland thing, these other families tell the same story. They say, you know, that Michael was a friend of the family and he stayed in the house and this and that, and he spent extensive time in our home and whatever else. They posture it as like a grooming and a like kind of getting in and like being all creepy about it. But Michael was friends with the Cassio family since the early 80s when all of those kids were very young.
Yeah.
And he remained friends with them. They tell a very different story about the nature of their relationship with Michael. Since Michael has passed away, Eddie Cassio, or Angel, I think is what he referred to him as, has come forward in the collection of songs that he claims that Michael and he recorded during that period in 2007 while Michael was staying at the Cassio home. I'm wondering if you can speak to that period of time and you know, when you're receiving MP3s and different things via email and burning discs for Michael. Was any of those things coming from Angel Cassio?
Yes. I know they did do some work because I know that there was a studio in the house, and there were times in which whether we ran a few errands for Mr. Jackson, things that he wanted and or needed, and we'd run out and get what we need to get, and we'd come back to the house, to the Cassio house, and we could hear them inside the studio working. You know, we can hear it. It was, you know, not hard to know that. So we knew they were working in the studio. Working on what? I couldn't tell you.
And how did the visit at the Cassio family home actually come to be? When Michael decides to pick up and go, and he's going somewhere, how does it actually work out? Because I think it's quite well reported that the Cassio family visit was somewhat sporadic. It's been said that he, you know, it's been said by Frank Cassio, one of the brothers, that Michael just showed up, like in the middle of the night, just showed up and stays for 3 months. Like, how, for you as the head of security, who has to detail things and make sure things can work and make sure that there's going to be no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, Michael's doing something like maybe slightly sporadic, or, you know, are they even going to answer the door?
Well, I knew early on, you know, from back in Vegas. Matter of fact, when Mr. Jackson first got to Vegas, Angel Cassio came to visit maybe within 2 days. So he was at the house in Vegas for a couple of weeks. So I knew that this was someone that was close to Mr. Jackson. So when we we left Vegas and went to Virginia, and we was out there for a couple of weeks, or was out there for a couple of months. But within that time, Angel came out and hung out. Just having seen him again, that did tell me that this was someone that Mr. Jackson trusted. And it was cool. And just passing by or being in the car and hearing their conversations, you know, some was personal, some was about business, music. So, you know, again, I just took it to the fact that this was someone that he trusted. So I was able to put my guard down, because my guard was always up no matter who was around him. So, but when I realized that this was someone that, you know, he had a personal relationship with, I was cool with it. So Angel came to visit us in Virginia, and he stayed for a couple of weeks. He left, went back to Jersey. And I was made aware that we would be going to Jersey soon. So I did make the preparations for extra vehicles for Mr. Jackson and the kids to take such a long trip comfortably. But I didn't want to have them driving in the SUVs for that length of time. But we did have a nice like a commercial van, commercial bus, that they was able to be relaxed. And, yeah, so being sporadic, I don't recall it being a sporadic move because I had to plan it. I had to plan the move.
Still on music, but a slightly different topic, is the purchase of the headphones. Can you speak to the feeling of that moment and tell that story?
I was assigned to get him some headphones, and I was looking for a good make. You know, I thought Sony was a good make without thinking what his differences were with Sony. Try to find some nice ones that, you know, was like some sound cam. Matter of fact, I specifically asked to get some sound canceling ones, and it was a little bit over $100, I think. It wasn't until I was in the house, maybe a day or two later, and I saw those headphones, like all discombobulated, like someone tore it apart. I'm like, those are damn headphones. I just went out and brought. Like, what's that about? But I did find out later, they said Sony.
In the news today, from the strange and weird
According
fact
to
file,
SF Gate, singer Michael Jackson's estate is heavily criticizing chamber. The new documentary the centering on the pop superstar of Neverland, saying it is tabloid In Neverland, two men, Wade Robson and James Safechuck, claim Jackson molested them when they were
in the last few weeks, a large amount of ugly, malicious information has been released into the media about me. Apparently, this information was leaked through transcripts in a grand jury proceeding, where neither my lawyers nor I ever appeared. The information is disgusting and false. The public is fine. They buy the tabloid. That will shut them down to make ugly stories and gossip and rumors and be vicious and evil and ugly. That is garbage. Don't buy it. Don't buy it. Don't take it.
Know what you can do for me? Kiss right here. Kiss right here. You're a spine, you're a goddamn stick. Go to hell. Every last one of you kids.
Yeah. This person deserved their privacy. You are not allowed to go there.
I'll never betray or deceive you, my friend, but you will do anything for money.
Leave me alone.
The jury in the above entitled case find the defendant not guilty of conspiracy as charged in count one of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count two, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count two of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count three, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of a lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count three of the indictment, dated June 13, 2005, for person number 80. Count four, verdict. We, the jury in the above entitled case, find the defendant not guilty of lewd act upon a minor child as charged in count four of the indictment, dated June 10th, 2005,
four-person number 80. Hi, this is Scott Ross, lead investigator on the Michael Jackson trial, and you are listening to the MJ Cast. Thank you for listening.
Bill, let's talk now for a little bit about what was going on towards the end of Michael's life. We know that Michael ended up being surrounded by some incredibly, well, for lack of a better word, shady people, including Conrad Murray, who eventually went to jail for manslaughter, being the person most responsible for the death of Michael Jackson. And of course, there were some other people around him at the time as well. John Branca, the co-executor of the Michael Jackson estate, was really starting to come back into Michael's life during this time. And there's many, many reports of Michael being terrified to be around that man. Did Michael ever voice to you any concerns about these kind of people, maybe like John Branca?
No, only thing I was put on guard or put on alert about was once this show starts to come to reality, I was going to start seeing the vultures come through. And it was true. Phone was nonstop. So I wasn't aware of any particular names of individuals that could be on alert about. It was just getting a heads up that he's about to go into King of Pop mode. Because for so long, we've been dealing with Mr. Jackson. He's about to go into King of Pop mode. And he stated that's where all the ugliness is going to come, start to come.
Yeah, and obviously the ugliness did come. You know, there's court transcripts that talk about Randy Phillips, the AEG executive, slapping Michael Jackson and throwing him into a shower right before the London press conference for This Is It. It was a shocking time for Michael Jackson, really. And obviously, all of these things were going on behind closed doors.
Oh, absolutely.
Otherwise, you would have done something about it, I'm sure. Did you see like a mental deterioration in Michael Jackson as he was getting closer to these concerts?
He was more withdrawn. He was tired. But then again, you have to understand, I'm seeing something different than who I've been dealing with. A long period of time, for the most of the time, we were traveling. We was away. He was spending a lot of time with his children. So that's the whole, this is it starting to come into play. It's a transformation to the King of Pop. And that person has to deal with a whole bunch of other people now. So, and there's a lot of requests being made. So I'm seeing, I knew something wasn't right. You know, if you've been around someone long enough and they're not as high spirit as they once were, they're not as talkative as they once were, you get the impression something's not right. I didn't feel like it was in my place to question. No. All I could do is just be there physically and answer if asked. So, but I did see just the whole preparation was taking a toll. It changed him.
Yeah. It's a very complex time in Michael's life. And thank you very much for going into detail there about that time period. And what we'd like to do now is to start talking about your book that you've written, Remember the Time, one of my favorite Michael Jackson books ever. And I'd like to ask, at what point did you realize you really wanted to get your story down as a book for people to read?
While I was at the memorial service, that's when it hit me. Looking at all these celebrities inside here and, you know, to get inside, get to the Staples Center when I first got down there, and I seen all these people, cops almost 7 to 10 blocks out, the traffic is blocked off. I'm like, yo, this is crazy. This is huge. That helicopters must have had every goddamn cop out there from LAPD. I mean, man. And just seeing a number of fans. And then when I got inside, I'm seeing all these celebrities. And I said, what the fuck are Kardashians doing here? When I saw them, I was like, and it just made me think about all the times that we were traveling, we was on a road. And hey, there were some times that we've got asked to leave hotels now, you know, whatever reason, credit card on file, being declined, management office, I can't reach them. It's just something wasn't right. We were not in a good place. So everybody that had my number, that needed my number, had it. I was easy to reach if you were going through his manager. I wasn't getting no phone calls from none of these people asking how he's doing, how the kid's doing. Like, that's what friends do. But when I got to the memorial service and I've seen all these celebrities in their best outfits and all the fans was outside, he left with a lot of unanswered questions about him. Like, he didn't get a chance to tell his story or a story. And I just felt at that moment, I had something to say. I had something to share. You know, I know it's not good to you do personal security for someone or anyone. You know, maintaining a form of confidentiality is key. But I felt his fans were owed something. And I felt I have some answers to some of their questions. I don't have a lot of answers. I don't have all the answers. I have some. And I want to share that because he's not here to share it. And there were some things about him just as a person, as a man, as a father. I want to share that too.
Yeah, and we thank you very much for following through and writing your incredible book and getting those stories down, because without that book, without Remember the Time, we would still have a lot of unanswered questions as fans, like you said. So it's a real boon to us, I think, as appreciators of Michael Jackson, to know the truth in those areas. It's sad, I think, that he didn't get to have the final say on his life. He went through a grueling trial in the mid-2000s. And it would have been great to see him return to the stage as well. Listen, when you first started the process of writing the book, there was an interview out I think before the book even came out, it was three of you guys sitting there. It was you, it was Javon, but there was another gentleman called Mike Garcia. Would you be able to tell us a little bit about what happened with Mike? He's not in the book. That I found that part a little bit confusing, but I'd like to know, what happened to Mike in the end?
It's been a topic I've been somewhat reluctant to speak on. We had a difference of opinion on how the project should go. I've often said that, yes, there are some things that we would probably never speak on. I know I won't. Are those things that are detrimental or inappropriate? No, nothing like that. It's just, I felt that there's some privacy moments, things that Mr. Jackson may have said to other people in my presence that I won't admit, I won't speak on that. Those are some deep personal conversations he's had with people, and I just happen to be an earshot of having heard it. So I won't repeat those things like that. But I'll just say Mr. Garcia felt we should have spoken on those things, and I said, I won't do that.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, I thought it might have been as much. And I guess all I can say is thank you for choosing to uphold Michael's privacy. And, you know, I can imagine there would have been some very, you know, private, confidential things that you would have been privy to being physically around Michael Jackson so much. And I think it's really noble of you to want to uphold his privacy. Listen, I want to ask about the publishers. You know, when you were shopping the book around, when you'd written it, did you find any particular publishers you were dealing with were wanting to push you to maybe make the book a little bit more salacious or include some things in there that were a little bit more juicy, more than, you know, the reality of what actually happened?
Okay, good question. And one of the things that I keep telling people, it was not easy. We got turned down when I first pitched my first manuscript. And when we went shopping around, just trying to get the deal, we got turned down by 36 publishers. We were told they don't do stories like this, or it's not enough, it's not controversial enough. Based on the manuscript, we can tell you guys have more to say. And maybe if you decide to share a little more controversial information, we can work something out. And I said, I don't have any controversial information. So I don't think nobody wanted the side in which the book was presented, publishers-wise. And I always said, I'm writing this book for the fans. I'm hoping somebody that will see it my way.
Yeah. And I must say the book's been incredibly well-received. I haven't seen too many detractors about it at all. Probably the only person I've seen that's been a little critical of it would have to be another Michael Jackson sort of collaborator by the name of Karen Fay, who was his makeup artist for quite a while. And I always found it interesting that she'd be critical of it.
She ain't been around. I wasn't on her watch. She wasn't on mine. So, but we were fortunate enough to, the way it kind of really happened, I was working for Andre Agassi High School in Las Vegas, Nevada, and I knew his attorney quite well. And I told his attorney, because Andre Agassi had just written a book, and I told him, I said, listen, we're trying to get a book deal. I'm getting turned down by so many people. You think your publisher, when Andre would help us out? He said, yeah, give him a call. He has his number. Gave him a call, sent him my manuscript. He told me the type of book that he did, but he think he knows someone that would be interested. So he sent the manuscript to them. They were in London at the time, I believe, but their assistant in New York got it, and their assistant read it. The assistant called him in London, Peter, called Peter in London, told Peter that he had a manuscript here by Michael Jackson's bodyguards. They want to do a book. And he said he wasn't interested in doing a tell-all book about Michael Jackson. And the guy told him, well, this is not a tell-all. These guys, you know, really with him. It's on a positive side. He sent Peter the manuscript in London. Peter read it. Peter called me, told me he liked the direction that it was being presented, and he wants to come to Vegas to meet me. And he flew to Vegas. The rest is history.
Fantastic. The rest is history indeed. And of course, you can get this wonderful book from a range of places. You can grab it on Apple Books. You can grab it on Amazon. You can get it from rememberthetimebook.com. There's a whole bunch of places you can get it. And I really encourage you to read it. It's one of the most important accounts of the later years of Michael Jackson's life that we have, and a great account of the real Michael Jackson, not the Michael Jackson that places like Leaving Neverland are trying to sell the world. So thank you very much again, Bill. And where can people find you online if they want to connect with you?
Yeah, I'm on Facebook under Michael Jackson Bodyguards. I'm on Twitter, Michael Jackson Bodyguards. I talk to fans daily. I answer questions. Getting back to the book, I have a limited copy. I have about 200 books that I was given by the publisher. I do sell these books. I created a website to give an idea what the book is about. The name of that website is rememberthetimebook.com. Again, I do sell I have a limited amount of books. I am autographing. And the money, one of the biggest things that Mr. Jackson did when he was here was he did a lot of contributions to the homelessness. As a big thing I'm part of now, I've been in part of it for some time. Every Saturday, every first Saturday of every month, I do a clothing drive, I do a food drive, and I pass out a lot of food, a lot of clothes to the homelessness here in Las Vegas. And any money that I've made, will make, book sales, go straight to buying food and providing a good day, a community service to our homelessness that are out there that just happen to be part of our less fortunate members of society. And I remember Mr. Jackson being very supportive to them, and in his name, in his honor, it is something I've continued and I will continue. So again, I have a limited amount of books. I like to, I've already sold maybe about 7 so far. I ship them free, unless it's outside of the country. Outside of the country, I do ask that they pay for shipping. Other than that, I get the books out.
Fantastic. And we can't wait to get the word out even more about your great, great book. Now, Bill, we've only got a couple of questions to go. We're going to wrap things up pretty shortly. And one of these questions is one we ask every single special guest that we have on the show, people that knew and worked with Michael Jackson. Bill Whitfield, how do you think Michael Jackson should be remembered?
Michael Jackson, I feel he should be remembered just for what he tried to do. He felt his music was the antidote to evil, to negativeness. You listen to his music, he felt his music was the cure. And he's often said he's made music based off, the thoughts and the struggles of children. I listen to his music more so now and even listen to words. So I think he should be remembered just for what he tried to achieve with his music. And that was kind of, no matter where you are, what you're doing, out hanging out with your buddies, friends, Michael Jackson's song comes on, everybody is connected at that very moment. Everybody in that club, in that arena, in that place, in that house, in that party is all connected right now, because we are all listening to some music that none of us any have to say, who the hell is that? We don't have to, because we all know. So right now, this very moment, we are all connected because we hear it. And that's what he felt his music would do, is to bring people together and just make it better. I think I would like to see people remember him as that, what he tried to do with his music. And in some ways, I think he has. In some ways, I think he has.
I love how you just put the focus on the music right there. That was great. Now, I've got to ask you, how's Jayvon doing? Do you guys still catch up?
Yeah, oh, absolutely, yes. He's out of town. He's on, taking care of a personal matter. But he's doing well.
Oh, fantastic. I really hope I get the chance to talk to Javon one day about his experiences. I think it'd be a great conversation. And I've got to ask, what are you up to these days? Are you still involved in executive protection?
Yes, I currently own a security company here in Las Vegas called Bulwark Security. And we do currently, one of the big things with my company, you know, we certainly provide, you know, everybody knows Las Vegas is a legalized marijuana industry now. Out of 30 some odd dispensaries they have out here, they do need security. So my company provides security for 14 dispensaries. We also provide security at T-Mobile Arena for special events. We also provide security at low-income housing areas just as a presence. We also provide security in the morning areas for where there are schools, where kids walk to schools. So I have like 8 people on my team that monitor the areas between the school, you know, just making sure nobody's getting snatched up, keep our eyes on our little ones. And one of my big things with my company, I'm employing students directly out of high school. Once they graduate, especially the ones that we can be all honest that they're not going to college. All these kids ain't going to college. So the ones that has their mind made up that they're not going to college, I'm training them in the art of security protection, getting them trained and certified, and I'm getting them a job. When I worked at a school, one of the students once asked me, he said, "Mr. W, you used to work for Michael Jackson?" "Yes, sir." "And P. Diddy?" "Yes, sir." He said, "You could work anywhere. Why do you work here?" I said, "You want the truth?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, I work here. So if I could stay here and help you get a good education, without a good education, you might go out there and just start robbing people. And guess what? You might try to rob me. And guess what? I'm going to shoot your ass." Oh, and wow. He understood just what I meant. So, I'm here to make sure you do what you're supposed to do. Do what you're supposed to do. We'll only see each other in the grocery store. Simple as that.
At the register paying for the food.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, Mr. W, it certainly has been a pleasure having you on the MJCast.
Yes, sir. Mr. W. Certainly appreciate it.
I'm going to call this episode the Mr. W Special.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you again so much for coming on from the bottom of our hearts, from Q, from Elise, from Damien and myself. We really appreciated it that you could join us and talk to us about the real Michael Jackson and how you had his best interests at heart. You know, if listeners want to find out more, they need to get your book, Remember the Time, because we've only scratched the surface, haven't we, Bill?
We certainly have. I think, you know, there's certainly more to share, more to talk about. I appreciate it. Thank you, young, for having me. It's been a while since I sat down and put deep thought into where I've been with Mr. Jackson. You know, it's a side of me I put to the side, but now that this situation has come up with this documentary, and it's like now, you know, I want to defend him. I don't want to feel I have to, but I feel there's a responsibility because you're talking about someone I knew. You're talking about a friend of mine. And let's all hope and pray that I don't run into either one of them dudes. Okay? Let's hope and pray on that. I don't ever want to see them.
I don't think I'm going to hope and pray on that.
Well, I don't want to see them because we got to have a sit down.
Well, I'm sort of hoping and praying that you do run into them.
You know what?
Yeah. I ain't going to hope and pray on that. That's
we need that sit down. What you told to the cameras on that documentary is one thing. What you gonna say to me is another. And if you repeat what you said on that documentary, we have a problem. We'll be right back.
Well, there we go. That was definitely a fun interview to record. I really like talking to Bill, especially at the end where he was making a couple of cracks there about what he'd do with Jimmy and Wade. Yeah, yeah. How do you think it went, mate?
I think it went well. It's always a good person to speak to. Bill's someone that I've interviewed a couple of times prior to this interview for another project that I've been working on. And, yeah, he's a good guy to interview. He's always open and honest and says it how it is. And I think this was no different.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it went really well.
Yeah, and he was there really for an incredibly mysterious and important part of Michael Jackson's life. You know, like you said in the intro to the show, this was a time when Michael was trying to rebuild his career after an incredibly difficult, you know, trial that went on in the mid-2000s. And it was only a few years later and Michael was dead. So Bill was there for a lot of that, seeing what happened. So there's still a lot to learn about that period, I think. And I personally hope one day there's a book that covers this period of time. You know, I mean, obviously we've got Bill's perspective and Javon's perspective, but man, there's so much still to learn.
Yeah, there's so much still to learn. And it's also a period of time that's kind of, I mean, you have to take someone's word for it really, which is a big struggle that we have today. Michael's gone. He can't really validate any of the stories that are going to be told. So, you know, doing our best to fact check and corroborate what people are saying about that period is important. But it certainly is interesting. It's certainly something that doesn't have much literature, which is, you know, why it's so mysterious to fans. And I think it's the kind of part of Michael's life that has no closure. It's that part of his life where he was working on music, but he never got to finish it. And a lot of that stuff is stuff that we've never heard. He was planning a concert tour, but he never got to perform it. And we'll never actually know what it truly would have looked like because he's not here to show us. Artistically and personally, it's going to probably remain the most mysterious part of Michael's life. And the people who really do know the stuff, like Bill and like people like Michael Prince and Brad Buxer, who were so close to Michael in that period, they're also good people. They also respect Michael's privacy, and they're not going to go out and talk about all of the things that really don't mean too much in the scheme of Michael Jackson, the king of pops. So.
I also got to say as well, since, you know, we recorded this episode and I put it out there that we'd be releasing it, I have heard from a couple of people on Twitter just voicing a few little concerns there around some of the things Bill has been retweeting or saying on his Twitter about leaving Neverland, things pertaining to, you know, some of the, you know, like footage or things like that in the film being faked. And I think it's important to note that, you know what, at the end of the day, there's a lot of fans out there that are trying to take elements of that film and make it look as though it's a conspiracy. And of course, overall, it is a conspiracy. It's these two guys trying to bring down Michael Jackson's name with no evidence. But there are some things in the film that, you know, I would suggest still are legitimate. And, you know, things like the handwritten notes, things like the, you know, the photographs in there. And I worry that there's fans out there that are desperate to make Wade and Jimmy look even worse than they already are making themselves look by sort of fabricating these conspiracies. And, you know, if you see Bill retweeting a thing or two on Twitter, then, hey, you know, maybe he's fallen victim to some of these things as well. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, we're all entitled to say what we want. And today, 2019, everybody has access to broadcast their views to the entire world. So, I mean, not everything that people tweet is true. Not everything that's in that documentary is true, but there certainly are some things in that documentary that are true. And, I mean, it's not Bill's job to fact check and validate everything. And, you know, he's just out there trying to stand up for Michael. I have seen a few things that he has tweeted that are provably incorrect, but he's human. So I'd say give him a break. I don't think he's out there maliciously trying to change the narrative of history. I think he just, you know, has people telling him this is not true, that's not true, and he's just trying to, you know, pass the message on, really. I mean, that's all it is on Twitter, isn't it? Someone posts something, you think it's true or you agree with it, you retweet it, and then all of a sudden you've said it because you've hit retweet. So it's a difficult prospect at the moment with everybody in the world being, you know, a citizen journalist.
Yeah.
It really has changed the landscape of journalism altogether. And I think that's why we find ourselves in a really troubling position with real journalists not actually doing their job properly either, because it's just all too easy to just quote and screen capture and retweet. And yeah, so we really have to be careful with the sources that we trust and the information that we believe to be true. Every single thing that we see in here, we should really be skeptical of, and we should scrutinize, and we should fact check, just like we're asking Dan Reed to have done with his film, which he didn't do. So we can't be hypocrites and not do it in certain instances where we feel that the piece of information that's been tweeted validates our opinion. We can't just be victims of our own confirmation bias. We have to be skeptical and scrutinize everything, because otherwise we're hypocrites.
Exactly. Now let's not get too deep into the Leaving Neverland rabbit hole, because on our next episode of the MJ Cast, our first regular episode of season 5, we'll be going deep into that. But speaking of scrutinizing evidence, we know that you, Damien, are putting together a podcast yourself called Faking Michael, and it is about the second biggest controversy in the Michael Jackson fan world these days, the Casio tracks. And of course, we talked to Bill a little bit about that in the interview. Listeners only got to hear about half of what you asked him. Cut a little bit out there, but basically, I'm waiting. I can't wait for your documentary or your audio documentary podcast to come out. And I think there's a lot of people in the fan community feeling exactly the same way. It's a shame in a way that it's been slightly overshadowed at the moment by this even bigger and more horrible controversy, because it must be difficult for you right now mentally to knuckle down and focus on that. Is that right? Or how are you feeling about it?
It's the never-ending project, isn't it? It's the thing that I've been talking about for 8.5 years, which still hasn't happened. And I'm sure people are kind of almost sick of me saying that it's going to happen. Probably I don't have much credibility there with trying to convince people that it is coming. But it is. Yeah, it is difficult to find the spark to work on it in a time like this, because obviously these allegations are killing everyone's spirits. And so, you know, when you're sad, you're not really feeling your most productive. Secondly, you're also, you know, me personally, I feel like I need to go in and do what I can to speak on the situation that is currently a news item. I can't be out there still banging on about the fake songs when the guy who is alleged to have recorded them is currently being painted by the media as a pedophile. I think there's, you know, bigger fish to fry at the moment. Yeah, I mean, the project is still going to happen, and I am still actively working on it behind the scenes when I have the time and energy, but I'm also trying to put a lot of my energy towards doing what I can, the very small part of the puzzle that I can, to give Michael a voice with all this craziness that's going on. So I would just please ask public and the fans to be patient with the Faking Michael project, because to me it's my life's work. It's what I've decided to dig in and make myself an expert on, and it's something that I'm going to speak with authority on. I feel like I've done so much research that people have never had the opportunity to engage with yet, that when they do, it will really change perceptions and clear up any questions about the nature of those songs. But I also don't want to try and force it down people's throats in a time where we are galvanized and united and marching forward to try and do something else great for Michael and the community. And I think that, you know, I have to be patient. The people in my life have to be patient with the fact that, you know, I don't control the way that this narrative unfolds, and right now we have to kind of do what we can for Michael and his legacy in the way that we're doing it. So Faking Michael is coming, but I don't know when. Hopefully at some stage this year, hopefully sooner than later. But as the story unfolds, we will we'll really get a picture of when I'm going to be able to, and when it's going to be suitable to put it out, because you don't want to put it out at a time where it's just not the right climate and people aren't ready for it. People don't want it right now. If I put it out right now, people will go, who cares? We've got more important things to deal with. And that's true, and I agree and acknowledge that. So we'll see.
But I want to, you know, you said before about you wanting to spend this time defending Michael and setting the record straight in the way that you can. And props to you, man, because you've done an outstanding job. You've been in the New York Times. You've been on ABC News in Australia. Just watching you work has been like, you know, it's been phenomenal. So definitely an inspiration for me and many other fans as well. Well done.
Oh, thanks, man. Do what I can. Each of us needs to do our own little part. That's all we can do. None of our jobs, none of our duties, but we feel it's an honor to do it. So,
how are you holding up?
It's tough, man, to be completely honest. It's you know, everything is just, it's completely, it's defeating. It really is. Because, you know, we're people with lives and friends and relationships and family and jobs and bills to pay, and we have a life to go about, but also then there's this weight that we should be doing what we can for a guy we never met. And it's difficult. It's difficult to juggle all the balls and to make it all work and to go to sleep at night and feel good and then and wake up with a smile the next day. It's a difficult time. So, and fans all around the world are suffering. It's not just you and me, it's everyone. So we can all relate to one another at this moment, and it's something that we just have to knuckle down and get through.
Yeah, and we will. We'll do it. We've done it before. We'll do it again. And we all need to remember right now that there are avenues that we can support to make this a much better scenario, and that is Taj Jackson's GoFundMe, which is online right now. You can find it. So the URL is gofundme.com/untitled-michael-jackson-documentary-series. And Taj has raised so far just under $92,000. It's $91,835. And of course, he's got that big goal there of $777,000, which we need to keep working towards. There's some projects out there that, you know, are suffering pretty badly. There was the Innocent campaign with all the bus adverts, which has just been made. Well, they've been cancelled basically by the advertising company that was distributing them around the place in London.
Jamie, can I just chime in on that? I think that's an outrage. That's an outrage that that's been cancelled. Those fans who all came together to raise the funds for that, they ought to take a class action litigation against the London Transport Department, because, I mean, they can't be censored in that way. They've met all of the required conditions for the advertising to be made public, and they've been silenced. And there's not just one person who's paid for that. That's a lot of people who've chimed in together to make that happen. All of their money has been wasted now, and Michael Jackson's voice has been completely silenced, and that's just – that's an outrage and an atrocity, and I'm not a lawyer, and I don't know UK law, but that does not sound legal. I mean, I think they really need to look into it and see what avenues they have to take action against London Transport. That's ridiculous. Ridiculous.
Yeah, it's the same thing when you look at a lot of companies around the world, whether it's Starbucks or, you know, Cotton On in Australia or this advertising company in London. In the Me Too era, people are, you know, companies are terrified with throwing in with perceived pedophiles. So it's a very, very sad reality. And I agree with you. People that have given money to that should not be silenced, because it's an important, truthful message to get out there. If you are thinking of giving money to something that is going to have a long-term benefit for Michael Jackson's legacy, please do consider Taj Jackson's documentary. We know he's working very hard with it and speaking to lots and lots of experts on the situation. What we need as a fan community is something bigger and better than Leaving Neverland, and something more truthful as well. So I've got very high hopes for what Taj can do. Moving forward, if you want to hear more of the MJCast, you certainly can. We are a podcast, so we'd love it if you could subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts or any other podcast app out there for Android. You can find us on our website, themjcast.com, which is a repository for all our episodes in the past. We're on social media at the MJCast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And we would love to hear from you as well if you'd like to send us an email at themjcast@icloud.com. We love hearing from Michael Jackson fans all around the world. Now, Damien, you've got a podcast that people could subscribe to as well. There's only a teaser out there at the moment for it, but episodes will be coming. Do you want to tell listeners where people can subscribe to you and find you on social media as well?
Yeah, sure. All the podcast platforms, you know, Apple Podcasts and Spotify specifically. It'll also be on YouTube. There's a trailer out on YouTube as well. You just search for Faking Michael. It should be the first thing that pops up. Like I said, subscribe, because you'll get the episodes delivered to you once they come. It's just a matter of when. I don't know when that's going to be. So please don't be mad at me that you've subscribed to my podcast and you haven't got anything for it for months and months on end. But it's out there. And if you want to contact me directly as well, I'm at Damien Shields on Twitter, and my website is damienshields.com. I don't have Facebook. I don't have any other of the social media. So just Twitter or my website, and you'll be able to reach me directly.
I also should mention as well, to remind people, that Damien, you are the author of a book as well. Do you want to tell people a little bit about that?
Yeah, Michael Jackson, Songs and Stories from the Vault. It's a book that chronicles 8 songs that were released after Michael died. It delves into Michael's creative process and tries to put the reader as a fly on the wall in the studio to see how Michael Jackson worked and to dissect the anatomy of his craftsmanship. The 8 songs that I've detailed in that book are the 8 songs that were released on the Escape album in 2014. And the reason I did that was because when those songs were released, there really wasn't much attention given to telling the public where the songs came from and how they ended up in the state that they were. So I'm really just trying to fill a void that was left by the estate when they released that project. I feel like that that there was a necessity to tell people about them and try to find the most compelling way to talk about Michael Jackson in a biographical sense while also detailing specifically the origin of those 8 songs. So the book was originally released under the title Escape Origins. It was a little bit less biographical at that point and probably only something that somebody who had knowledge of the Escape album could pick up and read and understand. So I have repurposed it. I rewrote it. I expanded it. I included new information. It's about 40 pages longer than it originally was. And the reason I wanted to do that was because I wanted it to be something that anybody in the public could pick up, open the first page and read through to the end and have a complete and full understanding of who Michael was, what his life story was, and his creative process as well. So a little bit more biographical than the first version.
Awesome book. I'm still waiting for my signed copy. The only copy of the new one I've got, except for my digital version, because I like my ebooks, but the only physical version I've got is a very, very rare Free Willy version.
Oh, yeah. I brought you a draft when we had a print run done, but it underwent additional changes. That's right. So I do have a few extra copies of the final version.
But I've got my one's really special. It what it does is it, if you leave it on a table, it curls up.
Oh, the Free Willy one. I understand what you're talking about now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My cover curls up.
The captive whale version. And you've got the animal cruelty version.
Oh, my God.
Oh. Yeah.
Anyway.
Peter would not be happy with that book.
Who's Peter?
What are they called? The protection of
animals? Oh, Peter, P-E-T-A. I thought you were talking about Peter, P-E-T-A, like a dude. Yeah. Like, who's Peter? I haven't met Peter. I thought you met Peter Jackson, that Lord of the Rings guy.
Yeah, that's one Jackson I'm not interested in. Thank you very much.
The MJ Cast.